and John, who seemed to be pillars, perceived the grace that was given unto me. What was that grace? To preach to the Gentiles. They gave me and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship that we should go to the who?
Yes.
What do you call them?
Yes.
What do we call us when we get married?
All right.
Dealing with rights here. that cut me off, boy, I tell you something. So he says, I'm going to the heathen, and they to the circumcision. All right. So that's there we go there. Leave that alone. Ephesians 3:8. What does Ephesians 3:8 say? Go and read that if you will. 3:8.
Ephesians 3:8.
Mm-hmm.
Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of
Christ. A Messiah. Christ, every time you see Christ, it means it's just, it's Messiah.
Okay.
I should preach to the Gentiles about Messiah. I should preach to the Gentiles about Messiah. Guess what? It takes a special anointing. Woo! Strike up the music lesson. It takes a special anointing to bring us out of the mess that we're in. Because we are brought up as and conditioned as losers in life. It takes a special anointing to say, see, to the Jews, you're the apple of God's eye. He promises the very best to you. He'll move heaven and earth and mountains for you. You're the apple of his eye.
They've been telling that all their life.
And, but to us, we come out of all type of circumstances. Us, we come out of slavery, up from slavery, and we've been beaten to submission, taken away, and no education. It takes a job, it takes an effort to say to us that you deserve the best in life and God will give it to you. But people are going to bust you out left and right.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes. Irene coming here with a leather jacket on. That brown one ain't. I told her I gave her a compliment. She wanted to go see my red one.
You gotta see one, let me know.
She is. She is. So it takes something to get us up to speed. It takes a special one. That's a job. So Paul says, was this given unto me? The ability to preach what? The unsearchable what? Somewhere. Unsearchable riches of Christ. Mercy. Okay, so he says, all they have to do is repent of what they're doing and start following Messiah. As the prophets have laid it out. Because the prophets spoke about him to come. All right, now let's get back to our lesson, because the stage has been set. Verse 21, for this cause the Jews caught me in the temple, in the church, right at the altar, and wanted to do what?
Kill.
Wanted to kill me, because I was going to preach to the Gentiles what was supposed to be said to me. Woo! Verse 22, someone help me out there, please.
Having therefore obtained help of God, I continue unto this day, with this in both to the small and great, saying none other things than those which the prophets and Moses did say.
All I did was preach what the prophets and Moses said. He had nothing else to go by. He hadn't written anything. Nobody else had written anything on this side of Christ or the cross. All I preached was those things which the prophets and Moses said would come to pass. All right. Okay, what did you preach? That Christ, that Messiah should suffer, and that he should be, and that he should be the first that should rise from the dead, and should show light unto the people. Light unto the people first, and then to who?
The Gentiles.
There it is, sister. Yeah. Gentiles get the gospel after the Jews. Then he distinguished the people and the Gentiles. Because we live like somebody who's blind. But we live like hogs. And we live like pigs. We live so far beneath our creation that we were not considered normal people. I mean, not even human. Gentiles? Are you kidding me? Sit down and eat with them? The woman at the well says, we Samaritans have no dealings with you who? Jews. I don't care if you're Jesus, God, or an angel. We don't talk to you. Why are you talking to me? And Jesus said, woman, if you knew who was talking to you, you would be asking a whole lot more. Your attitude would certainly change. She had no idea. And then he told her, you've been living with so many men. Chicken with so many men, that's how you are, you know, and the guy you with now, you ain't even that. How do you know that? Because that's how you are. But he was prophesying. He knew. He was looking into her life. She got up and said, come see a man that know everything about me. This must be that Messiah.
Even Jesus told the Syrophoenician woman that it's not meat that he should give him the children's bread.
Yeah, yeah. So they were considered as in the community, in the Jewish community, second class. At best, second class. Mm-hmm. All right. Okay. And people then. So what is it that the Gentiles are supposed to get when we preach to the Gentiles? You and I are sharing it one to another to non-Jews. What is it we're supposed to be saying to them? Romans 3:22. Somebody will say, well, Irene, you can't wear that red up in here. Sunday, child. You can't be coming to church in that red. So we're going to put her on the Mormons and walls and all like that. So she got to put her fashion down. Is that what we're supposed to preach to her? Curtis, you got to come out of that cap. That black cap. You gotta get a little bit more conservative. It's too much flash. Black cat. Still black cat. Too much flash. Once you saved, women be running all after you going down the street in that black Cadillac. What you say? Unfortunately, say another one. Don't you stay safe, brother. What does Romans 3 say? What are we supposed to tell the Gentiles? Romans 3:22. Anybody got it? I don't
know. The righteousness of God. You said 3:22?
Mm-hmm.
Even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and for all them that believe, but there is no difference.
Okay, right. So, faith of Jesus Christ, let's go on to Colossians 3:11.
And have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that's created him.
Okay, verse 11.
Where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision,
yeah.
Barbarian,
yeah.
Scythian, bond nor free, but Christ is all and in all.
Yeah, so therefore, he is saying now everybody is saved according to what the prophet says regarding the Messiah. You just got to believe. There's no more separation between Jew and Greek, circumcision or uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond not free, but Christ is in everybody. Christ is available, Messiah is available for everybody. Okay? That's what he's preaching. And for that cause, he sees himself in front of a court, a semi-informal court. And that's what it says, verse 24 of our lesson. And as he thus spake for himself, as Paul was giving his testimony, Festus chimed in. How many of you have been interrupted when he was trying to say something? Kind of gets to you, don't it? Yeah, but so not only did Festus interrupt, but he interrupted with a loud voice. Paul, you're crazy. Thou art beside thyself. Much learning do make thee mad. Because he knew that Paul knew what the, because he got nothing else going but by what the prophets were saying. Says, you're mad, you're crazy talking about people coming back from the dead. This is something in the Gentile world that you don't do. You don't come back, you don't bounce back from the dead. That's why they're so quick to kill one another. That's why the 22s and 21-year-olds right now in your neighborhood, my neighborhood, so quick to kill people to make him mad, because he ain't coming back. Oh, he's dead, he's out of my life. They don't believe in life after death. And that's what the Gentile, and Festus is saying, Paul, you're crazy, talking about, and see, Paul was referring to 1 Corinthians 15 and 20, 23, that Jesus will be the first one to come back from the dead. He says, that's what I believe in my heart, and I'm trying to share it with everybody else, that there is life after death, that you can come back. And Festus spoke up, Paul, you're crazy. Who ever heard of somebody coming back from the dead? You done learned so much, you're crazy. What did Paul say? But he says, I'm not mad. Now see, how many have shared the gospel and almost got into a fight? Don't raise, just raise our wound. You got into an argument because they ain't going along with you. No, I'm right. And then you try to, and you're about to go to blows trying to present Jesus. So here's what Paul did. He stayed cool. I'm not mad. Most who? No. Instead of calling him a name, don't we? You dumb. Call him most noble. That was cool. Great brother, great friend. You got it going on, but I'm not mad. He was cool. He could have called himself messy, you know. But he says, most noble fetus? Any Festus? I made Festus.
I could be mad at that one.
But I'm speaking words of truth and soberness. I'm in my right mind. Listen to me. And then he says, then he was slick about it. He says, I'm not talking to you no way. I was talking to a brother. You butted in. Watch the next verse, how he makes that point.
For the king knoweth of these things.
Yeah, see, I'm talking to the king. The king know what I'm talking about. I mean, you've been talking to somebody and somebody chime in. You say, I'm over here. What you done for? I'm talking to this guy.
Before whom I also speak freely.
I'm speaking to the king.
For I am persuaded that none of these things are hidden from him.
For
this thing was not done in a corner.
What is this thing? 30 years ago, Jesus, according to the scripture, this time said, 30 years ago, Jesus died and rose from the dead. And Agrippa, it ain't no secret to you. How do you know about these events and this stuff, Agrippa? How I know that you know this? Because you had you. You know. And not only that event, but you also know what the prophets been saying. Because you are what? You had you. You know what I'm talking about. I know Festus don't know nothing about the prophets and the scriptures. That's why he's so ignorant and butting in. You and I have had people like that don't know nothing about the Bible, but they butting in. Mm-hmm. Black power, white folks do this and that. They don't have nothing to do with it. I'm talking about here. I'm talking about the word. He says, but Agrippa, you know where I'm coming from, because you've been living as a Jew, and you even side with the Jews in the civil courts when they come up before you, because you know the Jewish customs and traditions, and you can follow what the prophets have said. Watch him pin Agrippa down.
King Agrippa, believest thou the prophets?
King Agrippa, question to you, my Jewish brother. You believe the prophets?
I know that thou believest.
And then he didn't give Agrippa time to answer, because Agrippa would have what? Compromised the court system, even though it's an informal court. Do you believe the prophets, Agrippa? And I know you believe it. If you don't have to say that. How many have been sitting with people that come up out of church, grew up in church, and they was acting wild, and you say, don't you know that? And I mean, you know what you're supposed to be. They got their buddies over here backing them up, acting all stupid and going on, but you know better. Don't you? You know better. It's like someone talking to my son, Donnie. Donnie, don't you know better than Bill? He's trying to act ignorant, but somebody that knows him, I know you've been brought up in the church. I know your dad and your mama. They didn't teach you that. Don't you? You know better than that, don't you? I know you know better. That's what Paul says. I know that thou knowest, that thou believest, because I know you, you're Jew. Then Agrippa, and most folks are taking this wrong, but I'm going to show you what's the right way to take this from the reading school of theology. So I'm going to go ahead and read it.
Then Agrippa said unto Paul, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian.
And doesn't mess with the class. Do you think Agrippa ever became saved? Did you think Agrippa ever got saved? From your historical reading of this.
I don't think.
You say who was?
Yeah, almost.
If you read it like this, without getting the right interpretation, what the word is saying, look at it again. Then Agrippa said unto Paul, almost thou persuadest me to be a what?
Christian.
Persuadest is what? Continuing on. You are convincing me to become a Christian. Mm-hmm. Your testimony, right here. You are persuading me. You are convincing me to become a Christian. I'm a Jew, but you are convincing me. That's what he said. Woo. That's what he's saying. You are convincing me. But guess what? In this court, I have no power. And not only is it your job to win this case, it's not your job to win this civil case, Paul. That's what the Holy Ghost is saying. It's not your job to win the civil case. It's your job to do what? Win Agrippa. Win the people that hear you. That's your job. To win them to who? Christ. It ain't the civil case that you're trying to win. You're trying to win hearts to Christ. That's where we got to see ourselves. We're trying to win hearts to Christ, not the civil case. A lot of times we go in the courtroom battling with whoever, the authorities, to win what? The case. Right, so my side, I'm going with the case. No. He's on your side to do what? Turn hearts. To repent. And Agrippa said, you're convincing me. You're convincing me. Festus is over there acting a fool, but I'm taking it to heart, which is have to charge y'all for it. Verse 29. Woo! Someone help me out. Verse 29.
And Paul said, I would to God that that only thou, but also that hear me this day.
I ain't just trying to win you. I'm trying to win what? Everybody that's hearing me today.
For both almost and altogether, such as I am, except these bones.
That's right. We all say they're Jews, just like I'm Jews. I'm trying to save everybody and all things that's different between you and me. I ain't saying no, just like I ain't never seen that. I killed a couple people just the other day. Remember Steve? I had him knocked off. I was there. So you're about me throwing people in jail all together. That was me a little while back. So I ain't no better than you. The only difference between me and you is that I'm in these chains. But I'm trying to win you to Christ. So we got to stop trying to appear as though we've been saved for so long, ain't no long, how about doing all day long? I'm just trying to convince everybody that hear me, I'm trying to win them to Messiah. And when he had thus spoken, the king rose up, and the governor, who was this Bernice? Where'd she go? Bernice, and they did set with them. In other words, Bernice is King Agrippa's sister. And they just happened to be traveling through where Paul happened to be being held. And Festus said, hey man, why are you here? I have a highly unusual case that I'm pushing on up the line. Why don't you hear what this guy has to say? Here it is. Isn't this strange? This particular civil case. Here it is. So Agrippa just listening. He had no power to make a decision or nothing. And when they were gone aside, they talked between themselves, saying, this man do what? What have you heard that before? About who? Jesus. So partner said, man, I gotta figure out what I let him loose. I don't see no reason to kill him. I don't know what's all this about. I let him go. And you would think that Festus had authority to let him go, but he didn't.
He didn't.
Now, in ministry, sometimes we think that everything that the Apostle Paul did was correct. But sometimes we, as hotheads, even though we say it for the Holy Ghost, Sister Irene never lost a tooth. I'm wearing a red jacket. We'll do something, I'll say something that bad move, not the right decision because you got hot. You get heated up. And that's what happened to Paul. He got heated up when they beat him up. They beat him up, left him for dead. And he said, and then it's okay, go about your way. He says, no way, I'm taking this all the way to where? Rome. Caesar, I'm taking this to Caesar because guess what? I'm a Roman citizen as well.
This is against the law
the way y'all been treating me. I'm going, taking this to court. I'm going to Caesar. They tried to let him go, speak up under the rug, but Paul wouldn't let him do it. I'm going to Caesar. Because he did that, he got what, shipwrecked? He went into a shipwreck, got bit by a snake, had to use his faith to shake the snake off and get everybody saved and stand in the will of God. He had to do all of that. And then all this and that, and then he says, well, Festus says, I would have let him go. Mm-hmm. Festus says, he got no reason to be bound up or to be facing the death penalty. So what I'm trying to tell us is that sometimes y'all have hot heads, even though we say it wouldn't be. Can put us in a position where you didn't really have to be in that position. Yeah, you don't have to really go through all that. The Holy Ghost is working overtime to save you, a crazy man. Okay, what do you say, verse 31 and 32? Someone read that.
And so they were gone aside. Mm-hmm. They talked between themselves, saying, mm-hmm. This man doeth nothing worthy of death or of bonds. Then said Agrippa unto Festus, mm-hmm. This man might have been set at liberty if he had not appealed to Caesar.
If he had not appealed to Caesar, he'd have been put upon that. But because the order reached Caesar, we got to make sure
we don't have no authority.
I have no authority over the situation. Mm. All we're trying to do is win hearts and minds, not the silver case. Uh-huh. We're trying to win hearts and minds. We're not trying to win the silver case. Hallelujah.
Just by being in the...
Thank you.